Throughout this entire course, we have been looking at a quantitative response variable and then various combinations of explanatory variables, both categorical and quantitative, when we're modeling the response variable, the quantitative response variable, as a function of those explanatory variables. In this video series and the next, we're going to change it up and we're going to look at a categorical response variable. In this first video series, we're going to have a single categorical response variable and a single categorical explanatory variable. So all of our data is going to be categorical, which is why I've named this video series Analyzing Categorical Data. When we move to the next video series, then we're going to expand and look at not only categorical explanatory variables, and not just one, but multiple categorical explanatory variables, but also quantitative explanatory variables. So we're going to start out simply here with this first series in this sequence of two video series and look at a single categorical explanatory variable and a single categorical response variable. First, I want you to consider two possible sampling models. That is, think about how you actually conducted the study. The first model is a model of independence. And in the model of independence, we would obtain one sample of data, and then we would measure individuals in that one sample of data based upon two categorical response variables. That is, we would ask individuals their responses on two variables. One response may be a potential explanation of the second response. Or we could just be looking at an association among the two responses. This would be called the model of independence because we're wondering if these two response variables are independent of one another. This should sound a lot like correlation as you know it. Think about correlation. You take a single sample and then you measure individuals on two variables and you see if those variables are related. Could one variable possibly be an explanation of another? Yes, which is why we expand to simple linear regression. We don't just stop at correlation if we're thinking one variable may not only be associated with the other variable, but potentially could explain at least part of the variation in the other variable. So when you're doing that, you're actually using a model of independence. Here's a diagram to clarify the model of independence. Categorical data analysis is conducted using the model of independence when observational units in one sample are placed into the mutually exclusive categories of two variables. So we have a single sample, and every participant in the sample is classified on two categorical variables. Here's an example. Researchers selected a random sample of 100 adults who consented to be in the study. Every participant completed a questionnaire that the researchers used to classify the participant as having a type A or type B personality. Researchers also checked blood pressure to determine if it was high or normal. So note we have a single sample of 100 adults and we're classifying them on the basis of two categorical variables. Do you have high or normal blood pressure? Are you a type A or a type B personality? Compare that to what I'm going to call the model of homogeneity. In the model of homogeneity, we have multiple samples and a single categorical response variable. This sounds like what we did when we learned about one-factor designs and using one-factor analysis of variance to analyze the data from those designs, except that in that example, those were quantitative response variables. We used one factor ANOVA when we had a single quantitative response variable and when we had a single categorical variable as an explanation that had different levels. So we could take multiple samples, that is, each level of the categorical variable would be representative of a population, and each other level of that same categorical variable would represent other populations. In this video series, we're going to focus on this second model of homogeneity, and then we're going to look in the next video series how we could actually create a model that takes into account both the model of independence and the model of homogeneity by using a single modeling framework. It's very much like the general linear model that we talked about in the last video series, except that we're expanding it to the generalized linear model, but we're going to look at that in a very limited basis, focusing just on logistic regression with a binary variable. I'll talk about that more when I introduce the next video series next time. But for this video series, we're going to focus on this second model, the model of homogeneity. So we think of taking individuals from multiple samples. Now, remember that those populations could be potential populations. So if you take individuals from one sample and then randomize them to conditions, you're in essence creating multiple samples that represent multiple populations that could exist. If you put individuals in a control group and individuals into a treatment group, well, those in the treatment group represent a population of all individuals who could be treated. Whereas in the control group, it would represent all individuals in an untreated population. Again, the major change from what we've done in the past is we've got a categorical response variable. So what would be the explanatory variable here? It would be categorical as well. If I am going to have multiple samples, those are multiple levels of a single categorical explanatory variable. So we're dealing with one categorical explanatory variable and one categorical response variable. Here's a diagram to illustrate the model of homogeneity. Categorical data analysis is conducted using the model of homogeneity when the observational units in multiple samples are placed into mutually exclusive categories. So here I have sample 1 representing population 1, sample 2 representing population 2, and every participant in each of these samples is placed into category A, B, C, or D. Here's an example that we're going to use throughout this video. This was a 5-year study to test whether regular intake of aspirin reduces mortality from cardiovascular disease. Physicians were randomly assigned to conditions and took either one aspirin a day or a placebo. So note that we have two conditions, two samples representing two populations, an aspirin condition representing a population of people who could take aspirin, or a placebo representing a population of people who do not take aspirin. And we're categorizing on the basis of myocardial infarction, a heart attack, yes or no, over a certain period of time. I believe this was 5 years. Now, the way we display data in both models, in both the model of independence and the model of homogeneity, is often through a contingency or crossbreak table. We can display data from both models in a contingency table, but the interpretation of the data, how we actually make conclusions about our outcomes when we analyze the data, and indeed how we even choose to analyze the data, depends upon whether we're in the model of independence or the model of homogeneity. In the two examples we just looked at, I had a contingency table in both of those examples. Here's the one in which we classified on the basis of blood pressure and type A or type B personality. Notice the frequencies indicate how many individuals are in each cell, and a cell is a combination of a level in one category and a level in the other categorical variable. So here the 8 represents high on blood pressure as well as type A, the combination of both characteristics. Similarly, with the example of model of homogeneity, the 189 indicates that there were 189 individuals in the placebo group that in the certain period of time had a heart attack. So we can use the contingency table for both models. Now, the graphical display that we use, and you can remember that from past videos and even your first statistics course, the graphical display you use when you're comparing two categorical or one categorical response variable with two levels would be a side-by-side bar graph. And we're looking at that here. We're looking at it as a kind of a three-dimensional bar graph. And in this case, it's not very telling because the bars are so small, because thankfully heart attacks are rather rare. So relatively speaking, not as rare as we'd like them to be, but relatively speaking, they're rare. And as I look at this bar graph, it looks like the placebo bar might be just a little bit higher in the yes category than aspirin. But let's dig down to the descriptive statistics and see what they look like. And here's a contingency table. So on one dimension of this table, we have the explanatory variable, and that is the treatment condition, placebo or aspirin. And in the other, we have the yes or no, whether or not they had heart attacks. Now notice the total here. We have 22,071 physicians that were in the study throughout the course of the study. And so I mentioned it was a large number. I think, again, it was over 5 years. And so you have about half of them that had a placebo and about half that had an aspirin. And probably they initially, it was probably exactly half and half, but you might have had dropouts in the study for various reasons on related to the heart attack. Okay, so in this study, because we want to account for differences in sample sizes, it's going to be good for us to focus on proportions or percentages. And here they're being listed as percentages. And notice that the percentages add up to 100% in each row. So what we're looking at are percentages that are conditioned on the row. We call these conditional proportions, or in this case, conditional percentages, conditioned on a row, meaning that the first row placebo, the proportions or percentages are only calculated from the 11,034 that are in the total for placebo, and in the aspirin, they're only calculated based upon the 11,037 in the aspirin. And then even the total here is given as a row condition. That is, we're looking overall what happened in the study, regardless of what group of the 22,071, 293 had a heart attack, and that would be 1.33%. So that's why those bar graphs had real small bars for the heart attack, because it's only, and I say only in quotes because heart attack, we'd rather eliminate it entirely, that 1.33% is, relatively speaking, a small number, not considering the severity of this particular disease. All right, so let's take a look now at an R notebook and see how I obtained all these things using the R statistical programming language. So the first thing that I'm going to do here is enter the data not from a spreadsheet, which I normally do, and the original authors may have done it that way, but I did not actually have that spreadsheet. I actually had the summary data. That is, I had what we saw over here in terms of the numbers, the 189, the 10845, the 104, the 10933. That's what I had. And so that's what I'm putting into a matrix here. So I'm putting it into a matrix using the matrix command. I'm telling it how many columns there are, that there are going to be two columns, and I'm telling them that I'm going to enter the data by row. So that 189 and 10845, that's on the first row that we saw right here, the 189 and 10845. So that's how I entered this in. Now, if I was the original researcher, what I would have is I would have a spreadsheet. And on that spreadsheet, I would have, let's see, what was it? 22,071 rows. And those 22,071 rows, I would probably have, I'd have to have at least two columns, but I might have had three. I might have had an ID number for the first column that doesn't show up here in the table or in our analysis. And then I would have had what condition they were in. And that would have simply been a binary variable, that is a variable with two possibilities, either placebo or aspirin. And then I'd have a final column, the third column, would have been yes or no, where we tracked whether or not they had a heart attack. And so I would have that large spreadsheet, at least large in terms of the number of rows, 22,071, and I would have read this in using the read.csv, as you've seen me do over and over again in past videos. So in this particular case, I'm changing it up a little bit. I'm entering the data in that's been already handed me in summary form, but remember the unit of analysis here is still a person, in this case, a physician. I'm indicating now the names of the columns. I'm putting here the column of heart. Now, I could have this the other way around. I could have done rows one way and columns the other. But in the way I'm setting it up here, the columns are going to be the actual response variable. The column names for this matrix I'm calling heart are going to be yes and no, and the row names are going to be placebo and aspirin, and that's the explanatory variable. Again, we could put the explanatory variable in the column and the response in the rows, but it all depends upon making sure we match it up with how we entered the data up here on line 11. So I'm going to now take that matrix and I'm going to create it, I'm going to change it, transform it into a table. And so I'm using the as table command and see what that gets me. And I can actually compare that to make sure that I've entered it correctly by comparing it with what you're seeing over here. And I think that that's indeed correct. We've got the same numbers in the columns and the rows, and you can check me on that if you want. So those are frequencies, but we don't want the different sample sizes to influence our analysis, so we need to use conditional proportions given the way that the table is set up. So let me go ahead here and create the proportions. There they are. And this one here means I'm going to condition on rows. If I changed it to a 2, it would mean I'm conditioning on columns. Normally in R, as in much of mathematics, the first dimension that we consider, or the one we consider the first dimension, is the row, and then we consider the column as the second dimension. So the first dimension here is what I'm conditioning on, and that gives me these row proportions that you note add up to 1 on each row. They don't add up to 1 when you take all 4 of these values, they add up to 1 for each particular row. And so that's actually how I obtained what you saw in this table here. Here it's given as percentages, but all I need to do is multiply my proportions by 100 or move the decimal place over a couple places in order to turn it into percentages. Once I have this, I now can get a bar plot. Now, normally I like to look at graphs before I look at descriptive statistics, but in the case of the bar plot and the conditional bar plot, you actually have to create in terms of your statistics first and then give them to the bar plot. So we could go ahead and look at the bar plot first, and that's what I actually showed you first was the bar plot, but you're going to have to create those statistics in order to get the bar plot, but you could examine that first and then go back to the statistics, no problem there. So I'm going to use stacked bar plots, side by side, which is what I showed you in the presentation image. Those are fine as well, but I'm going to use stacked bar plots. Now the bar plots expects to see my proportions of interest in the column format rather than the row format. Note that we have the proportions of interest here. We have them conditioned on column, but in the bar plot, it expects them to be conditioned or we have them conditioned on row, rather. The bar plot expects them to be conditioned on column. So how can you deal with that? If you have your proportions as a row and you want to switch them to columns, you can just use the T function. T stands for transpose, and that means to transpose the columns to rows or the rows to columns. The bar plots are going to be hard to read, of course, because the proportion of myocardial infarctions is relatively low, thankfully. But there they are. And yes, indeed, you can see a little bit thicker line in the placebo group than in the aspirin group. Now, you might say, well, is aspirin really making a difference here? Well, if it is indeed the aspirin that's responsible for the line being a little bit thinner for aspirin, given that we're dealing with something so serious, small effect sizes, apparently small effect sizes, things that look like small numbers could actually be quite important, and I would consider that to be the case here. All right, so that is how we get graphs and descriptive statistics when we have a single explanatory variable and a single response variable, both of which are categorical, and in this case, both of which we have two levels. In a later videos, I'm going to give you an example in which we have more than two levels of the explanatory variable, but here we just had two levels of each. But now we need to talk about inference. So we've looked at description, we've looked at the graphical display, but can we infer what we're seeing here outside of this study? Are those differences we're seeing, that little tiny difference between the aspirin and the placebo, or looking at the statistics here, the difference between we have what here, 1.7% in placebo had a heart attack, and a little under 1% in the aspirin had a heart attack. Is that just an artifact of the study? Because remember, every time you take a sample, you're going to get sampling variation, and every time you randomize, you're going to get variation due to the way you randomized. If I'd randomized differently, these numbers would be different. So we need to know if we can actually take this outside of this study. And that's what we need to look at in the next video as we take on the topic of inference in this categorical data analysis scenario.